Hello, namaste, good morning everyone. I welcome you all in the lecture series on Introduction to Western Philosophy. And Dr. Mariano Iturbe is with us and he is giving us all the valuable knowledge about different periods and different philosophers who belong to the Western culture, starting from Greece and how the development happened in the later period. So in the previous sessions, we discussed about Socrates, we discussed about Plato, we discussed about Aristotle, and in the lecture series, now we are moving ahead and I request Dr. Mariano Iturbe, sir, please to start with today's session.
Thank you, Rudraksha. So very good morning to all of you. I'm glad that we have today the fifth class, so we are advancing, we are going forward in this trip throughout the history of Western philosophy. And today, even though the original title was Plotinus, but the title, I think, is a little longer, we can call it Greek philosophy after Aristotle, Plotinus, and the originality of Neoplatonism. And first of all, to understand, no, in this course, we try to see the correlation between history and evolution of civilization and philosophy, because they go hand in hand. And when we talk about Aristotle, died in the year 322, and the history or the period of ancient philosophy in Greek ancient philosophy ends in the year 529 approximately, when the academy is closed. So we are dealing with a long period of almost 800 years. So a lot of things happened, but clearly the summit was that period of Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. That trio was the summit of Greek philosophy. And then towards the end, when we have Plotinus, it's like the other summit, you know? So we can put them all together among the greatest Greek philosophers. But what's happened in between? In between, we have this that we call the Hellenistic period. We can start now sharing the screen. Okay. So we are here. The Hellenistic period, that is the time when, especially Alexander, after the death of Alexander the Great, in which the Greek cultural influence and power was at its zenith in Europe and in Asia. So as you see in the map, then we will understand more, no? But what is in white is the Mediterranean Sea, but then you have what is Egypt, that was a Ptolemaic kingdom, then all the Persia and part of Asia Minor, the Seleucid Empire, the Macedon Empire, and covering also mainland Greece, etc. So all these areas have been conquered by Alexander the Great. But Alexander the Great's untimely death, he died in very young and in the year 323, created a vacuum, created a crisis. During this time, of course, Alexander the Great has the idea of an empire, no? Developing a Greek empire and transmitting all the Greek values and all over these lands. Somehow, during the period of Hellenism, the famous cities that were famous during the time of the Greeks, during the Hellenistic period, are replaced by some new cities or ancient cities that acquire new importance, like Rome, Alexandria, Antioch, Pergamus, etc. So the problem is that after the death of Alexander, in the year 323, there was a big crisis, political crisis, among the generals who were accompanying Alexander the Great, and was the war of the Diadochi. Diadochi means successor. So all these generals who were being in charge of helping the emperor, Alexander the Great, well, they began to, each one of them wants primacy. Each one of them wants to become the head. And then there was that succession war, no? Who will rule? Who will be the new Alexander? And well, I will give some just pieces of data because it was a very, first because this is not a history class, it's philosophy class. And second, because it was really a complicated series of events that led to the succession of Alexander the Great. And in fact, those generals became governors of particular territories. So that main idea of the empire that Alexander the Great had remained undone because somehow each general wanted to have power in his own territory. So after the death of Philip Alexander the Great, it was proclaimed as king Philip III. The father of Alexander the Great was Philip II of Macedonia. No? So Philip III, but Philip III was an illegitimate son of Philip II, and he was mentally impaired because he was unsuitable for ruling as king, but he was proclaimed king. But as I was telling you, the history was quite complicated at that time. Few years later, he was killed, Philip III, by Olympia, who was Alexander's mother, so the real wife of Philip III. And then the other who was proclaimed king together with Philip III was Roxanne's son, also the wife of Alexander the Great. And he was born after his father's death in August that year and was given the name of Alexander the Fourth. Both were only figureheads without real power. As I said, Philip III was killed a few years later, and everyone was waiting till Alexander the Fourth comes of age, expectedly in the year 305, so more or less 18 years after the death of Alexander the Great. But he and his mother, Roxanne, were killed by Cassander, one of the generals, in the year 310. So now we can say the way was clear enough for the generals to govern and to have power. Those who were more or less related in one way or another to Alexander the Great and his father Philip II were no more. They had been killed. So after all these eventualities, so the centers of power changed. Athens was not anymore a center of power, or Sparta. Now the centers of power were Macedonia. If we go back to the map, Macedonia was this part in green, dark green here, that is the northern part of, bordering with Greece. The other was Syria, here we have Damascus and all this area that is Syria nowadays, and Egypt, of course, where we have Alexandria here in yellow. So those were the centers of power, but the battle continued and several wars succeeded one after another. Finally, 40 years later, after the death of Alexander, more or less in the year 281, the situation stabilized, and now, yeah, we have four major domains. And again, in yellow, the Ptolemaic dynasty in Egypt, capital Alexandria. Then the Antigone dynasty in Macedon and central Greece, here on the left, in Greece, in green, and then below, various colors. Then the Seleucid dynasty in Syria and Mesopotamia, all these very extending up to India. and the Attalid dynasty in Anatolia, with the city of Pergamos here, that is Asia Minor, what is today Turkey. So these were the four generals who were governing, were ruling, and each area has its own important city and important monuments, etc. But this, that I say, was more or less established in the year 280. 60 years later, will again be destabilized because Rome, that was little by little becoming an empire, entered in contact with the Greek world. And that will create great instability in Greece. In fact, but of course, after many years, no? In the year 146 BC, Macedon was annexed as a Roman province. And then Pergamus became the Roman province of Asia, later Syria. So the Roman Empire, after all this, so the Greek Empire, after all these years of wars and the wars of the Diarchy, of successors, ended as a world dominated by Rome. But in between, philosophy was progressing. Philosophy was carried out. But as you see, was not that period of stability, in spite also of the wars of the time, of the peak of the years of Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, with Athens at the center of Western culture and of Western philosophy. Now, the panorama, the map, is much bigger. Here, well, in the big cities, we have famous monuments. For instance, in Alexandria, there was, this is a replica, no? But a library, the Biblioteca Alexandrina, means library, that was the most important library at that time, that were unfortunately was destroyed by a fire, so a lot of manuscripts and original texts were lost in that library. In Antioch, for instance, we have this aqueduct in Syria nowadays. In Pergamum, there was also a big altar. Now is this is also a replica, and is kept in some museum in Germany, in Berlin Museum. Ephesus was famous for the great temple of Artemis, the goddess Artemis, that was one of the several wonders of the world. And in that, the same city of Ephesus in Asia Minor, one of the post-Aristotelian writers, Celsus, had his own library. So you see, no, how Hellenism was spread in all these cities. The language was Greek. So even in Egypt and in Syria, in the cultural scenario, no, the people were talking in Greek. So, and the power of each city also diminished. All decisions were kept in the hands of the new sovereigns. And especially the Greek citizens, little by little, lost some of their privileges. For instance, before, if you are a Greek citizen, well, that means if you are a Greek, you are a full-fledged citizen. While, for instance, an slave will not be a Greek citizen. So the difference between Greek and barbarians, non-Greeks, became minimal, practically was almost the same. So these privileges were lost with the new political developments. And as I said, the commercial centers that before were Athens and Corinth and Sparta moved to Alexandria, Rhodes, Pergamon, and Antioch. Well, and even from the point of view of cultural development, philosophy continued, but as I said, was not as prominent as in the previous centuries. But you have also other areas that evolved in those years, like astronomy, mathematics, and medicine. And you have Galen from Pergamon, medical doctor, or Euclid, who book Elements was the masterpiece, the basic textbook on geometry till the 19th century, and Archimedes that also from the first century. And in all these great cities, you have scientific institutes, museums, libraries. So there was a lot of importance given to culture also during the Hellenistic period. But logically, the level of philosophy was affected. Philosophy perhaps not abandoned, but dedicated less time to metaphysical topics and more time to ethical topics and political topics. Also, philosophy became a little more individualistic in the ideas about the good life of each person, and also the interest in cosmopolitanism, the idea of exchange among various civilizations. There was a movement and a exchange between the new cities located in different areas of the world. So, if we analyze this period after the death of Socrates in the 322, just 1 year after Alexander the Great died, till the end of the end of the academy in the year 529, we can more or less consider the following division of period of philosophy at that time. You see the number one, from the end of the 4th century BC to the middle of the 1st century BC, so 3 centuries, we have especially 3 schools, Stoicism, Epicureanism, Skepticism. Representative of Skepticism was Philo. So these are 3 schools. We will analyze later on what do they teach. The middle of the 1st century BC to the middle of the 3rd century, we have a continuation of skepticism. Somehow, after having reached the summit of philosophy, of metaphysics with Aristotle, later on, there was a tendency to deny the capacity of knowledge that human being has. Also because after the death of Plato, after the death of Aristotle, there were various schools, and sometimes the schools were opposing the interpretation. What did Aristotle say? What did Plato say? Etc. So a tendency to skepticism was prevalent there in all those centuries. Eclecticism, as you know, means mix various doctrines. So you take a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and you produce something new. And the third point is from the middle of the 3rd century of this era to the middle of the 6th century, Neoplatonism. And there we have Plotinus as the founder of Neoplatonism. It represents the final intellectual effort of Greek philosophy, of ancient Greek philosophy. So more or less, we have divided this 900 years in 3 blocks of 3 centuries each. Clearly, out of the 3, the 3rd one is the most relevant from the point of view, from the importance of philosophy and metaphysics. So of these 4 groups, there is something that is not mentioned here, but I would add also in the number 1, in addition to Stoicism, Epicureanism, and Skepticism, the Cynics. The Cynics were considered like themselves, literal followers of Socrates, not only in their teaching, but also in the way of life. And sometimes Diogenes, that was the founder of the Cynics, was a very extravagant character, and he went far away than Socrates could have done with his own extravagance. So the Cynics, sometimes we will not talk too much about them, but sometimes they were not perhaps portraying a very positive view of what philosophy is. Philosophy with the Cynics were not something very extreme, very radical. But in all of them, the cynics, of course, but also the skeptics, the stoics, the Epicureans less, but they had a great admiration for Socrates. Socrates remained, in spite of being a person who had not written anything, remained a great influencer on Western philosophy, on Greek philosophy during those years. So when we talk about Stoicism, we are more or less contemporary, a little after Aristotle, from three, we have Zeno and Chrysippus. Zeno founded the school, and the school, because the area where he was teaching, where he had his school, was called Stoa, S-T-O-A. From there came the name Stoicism. The same happened with Academy. Academy came from the god, the temple to the god Academo, and Lyceon to Lycaeus, etc. And Stoicism comes from the area where the school founded by Zeno was located, called Stoa, S-T-O-A. So we know very little. He didn't write anything, only he wrote some things that are lost, only few fragments we have of him. It seems that he committed suicide, though it's not, this is just some tradition in the history of philosophy, but it's not proved. The important thing for the school of Stoicism, even if Zeno has been always considered as the great founder, the one who really taught and transmitted the teachings of Stoicism was Chrysippus. He's the follower of Zeno. He is considered the second founder. Well, Stoicism dealt with logic, in fact, developed, continued the formal logic developed by Aristotle. In epistemology, so in theory of knowledge, they rejected the Platonic doctrine of the theory of the forms, the idea they are transcendental universals that live, so universal concepts that live, exist in the suprasensible world, in the cosmos noetos. They also reject the opposite doctrine of Aristotle. Aristotle will say, no, the universals exist, yes, in the but they exist as universals without not in a physical place, but they are materialized in each concrete being. For example, we have the universal, this is the concept of human being, and the human being, where does it exist? No, the universal in itself does not exist, but exists materialized in each individual, in each human being. So, but this was this idea of the concrete universal was rejected by the Stoics. For them, only the individual exists, and we only know particular objects because they make an impression on the soul. So they give also a lot of importance to the value of sense perception. Remember that among the pre-Socratics, Parmenides and Heraclitus, especially Parmenides, questions the validity of sense perception, because sense perception does not give me knowledge of whatever is permanent, and instead, so the value of sense perception is not great. So instead, the Stoics gives importance to sense perception. As I said, all these philosophers always look at their own past, at their own predecessors. In the case of cosmology, the Stoics had recourse to Heraclitus with the idea of fire as the archea, the principle of everything, and the idea of a logos, a reason, ordering all that apparent chaos of things, of changing things. So in the end, for soul and reason and matter, everything is material. Plato, the Stoics talk about, we can say that their doctrine is a sort of monistic materialism. There is a complete materialism. And God is the actifier, the primal source, from which all the elements of the world evolve. And God is the soul of the world, the consciousness of the world. And God contains the seeds, logoi spermatokoi in Greek, the seeds from which all beings of the world evolve. Now, in another very important concept prevalent among the Stoics, as I said, the Stoics had a lot of influence, is that, well, there is an eternal recurrence of the world. So the world ends and begins again, ends and begins again. And each new world resembles the previous one exactly in all of its details. That is why the Stoics deny human freedom. Or human freedom is to accept and to identify myself completely to that God's will. But it's an eternal recurrence. So a sort of determinism. The Stoics believe in fate. What will happen tomorrow to you is already there because it has already happened in the previous recurrence of the world. So from the primeval fire of God, then through a universal conflagration, the world is destroyed and it starts again. So the Stoics affirm that the wise man consciously follows the path of destiny. In the end, the important thing, from an ethical point of view, is to try to identify ourselves with that fate, with that deterministic evolution of the world. And ethics, together with this identification with God's will, so ethics is conceived as a science of behavior, and happiness consists also in a life of virtue, but virtue that is to live according to my own nature and according to reason. So there should be, again, I repeat, agreement between that human will and divine will. They give importance to the cardinal virtues that Plato started to talk about, and then Aristotle, the four cardinal virtues: prudence, justice, fortitude, and temperance. In the end, the important thing is to achieve that apathy, no? Apathy not in the good sense, that means that I'm not affected by the external world. Even if today is hot or today is cold, I'm happy. Today I'm sick, today I'm feeling fine, I'm happy. No? This is sort of acceptance, full acceptance of whatever is happening to me, whatever is happening in the world. So for the Stoics, it's very important to eliminate all passions and affections, not to integrate passions and affections within ourselves, that could be defined in Aristotle, but for is to suppress them in order to obtain that peace of mind, peace of life. Another importance, also that we find in Aristotle, but in the Stoics, is that cosmopolitanism, so every person is social by nature. And therefore, men, even though we live in cities, we live in countries, but we are citizens of the world. They try to emphasize the idea that we are citizens of the world, and this should lead to a sort of a universal love for every human being, in order that we can also progress and preserve ourselves. So the ethical ideal for the Stoics is an increasing tendency of self-preservation so as to embrace all humanity at large. Well, these teachings of the Stoics that were prevalent in the third century BC, third and fourth, continued throughout the century. So we can talk of early Stoic school, middle Stoic school, and later Stoic school, in which there was the presence of skepticism and also eclecticism. We have three characters or three philosophers who were outstanding during that period. Okay, this is, I haven't shown before, but this is what we spoke. Just I explained, so philosophy is a way of life. those three Stoics, Epictetus, Seneca, Marcus Aurelius. Marcus Aurelius became emperor of the Roman Empire for almost 20 years. Seneca was a tutor and minister of to Nero. Nero was one of the most famous Roman emperors, a despot, a cruel Roman emperor who killed enormous amount of people. But, well, Seneca will emphasize the importance of conquering our own passions and walk along the path of virtues. Epictetus was a slave who later on was released and founded a school, also emphasized the importance of good action, the importance of virtues, and also the importance of providence in the plan of God for mankind. And Marcus Aurelius was a person who tried to reaffirm the gods of the state. And so for him, good citizenship implies state worship. And that is why during his 20 years of rule, there was an important or serious persecution to Christians at that time. So these were the Stoics. Now we go to the second school, the Epicureans. The founder is Epicurus, again, for 3rd century BC, like the beginning of the Stoics. Third is, another is Lucretius, that he lived in the 1st century BC, so it's almost two, three centuries after Epicurus. Now, whenever we talk Stoic, we think of a sort of a ethical way of life, tough way of life, control your passions, control your affections, suppress any strange movement. And well, perhaps that is a little bit of an exaggerated view of Stoics. But Epicureans sometimes are depicted in the opposite way, no? Because Epicureans talk about pleasure at the end of life. So usually you use the word Epicurean to talk about someone who the only interest in life is for him or for her the fulfilling satisfaction of all type of pleasures. But this also will be an exaggeration because we will see that pleasures perform an important role among the Epicureans, but always under the power of reason, under the governance of reason. Epicurus again moved to Athens in the 4th century BC. He opened a school. Most of his works are lost. So again, as it has happened with other philosophers of antiquity, we know details of his life or their life through the book written by Diogenes Laertius, who was the first historian of philosophy, even though sometimes his data are not fully accurate because of the limitations of the time, but is somehow the most important source of, one of the most important sources of history of philosophy for this period of late antiquity, late Greek philosophy. So there was Epicurus was a sort of a religious leader, not only a philosopher. So there was a cult to his personality and to his founder. And for Epicurus, dialectic and physics are useful only as far as they serve ethics. For him, ethics was the most important aspect of philosophy. Ethics in the sense of right behavior. Sometimes even he will have a negative approach to mathematics or to scientific endeavors, etc. So philosophy has the purpose of liberating man from the fear of the gods, from the fear of death. He denies the immortality of the soul. So for him, there's only one life. So there's no reincarnation. There is no also immortality, life after death. So we can say that Epicurus was an atomic materialist. Remember that among the pre-Socratic philosophers, one of the latest pre-Socratic philosophers was Democritus, who spoke about the atoms. The atoms were those indivisible units out of which, through to the different movement and collision among the different atoms, the things of the world evolve. So the materialism of Epicurus was implied an attack on divine intervention. And the greatest good is pleasure is the end of life. Okay? Pleasure refers to those pleasures that endure a lifetime, not something that gives me a satisfaction for one day or one week. They consist rather in the absence of pain than in positive satisfaction. Again, the serenity of the soul, this tranquility, ataraxia, it is written on this slide. No? The greatest good is to seek modest pleasures so as to attain a state of tranquility, ataraxia, together with freedom from fear, as well as absence of bodily pain. That is happiness. Remember, what was happiness for Aristotle? Eudaimonia in Greek. No? Happiness as the final end of life was a life according to virtue. And virtue was the right reaction in the right circumstances, guided by reason. And which reason? Not only my own reason, but the universal reason, sort of a natural law. So you see how different is Epicureanism ethics from Aristotelian ethics, even though in the end, more or less, they share the same idea of happiness at the end of life. But the interpretation of happiness for Epicureanism is quite different from the concept of happiness for Aristotle. And if we talk about Plato, even more, the difference is bigger. So Epicurus and Epicureanism was not just a life of debauch. No, it's a moderate hedonism with an emphasis placed on absence of pain as the great pleasure and its advocacy of a simple life. For that is why the Epicureans, against the Stoics and against Plato, against Aristotle, they talk about don't get into politics. Politics will ruin your life. Politics will be an obstacle for your happiness, for your ataraxia, for your tranquility. The idea of Epicurus, just a peaceful life, perhaps to live in the countryside, in a comfortable house and enjoy nature, etc. It's a don't get in touch, don't have many friends. So a little bit of selfish also approach to life. No? I don't bother you, don't bother me. But at the same time, it was quite egocentric. Epicureanism requires an analysis of the different pleasures to choose. Okay, this is a long-lasting pleasure or no, this is a fleeting pleasure. And there is a need of a highest virtue, phronesis, a sort of a prudence, that will lead me to, in this act of choosing, the right pleasure. So, Stoics, Epicureans, I spoke that skepticism is very much present as a school and also in the evolution of the two great traditions, the Platonic tradition, that is those who continue the teachings of the academy, the school founded by Plato, they have that tendency towards skepticism, that lack of trust in human reason. And also skepticism is present in the followers of Aristotle, the peripatetics, as they are called. The school of Aristotle is also called with this sort of a nickname, the peripatetics, because they were teaching very often while walking. From there comes the Greek word peripatetics, walking people. In the new academy, so we have Cicero, first century BC, who was a very important person. And we see that, yes, he was trying to fight against skepticism, falling into dogmatism, but at the same time, it was a sort of eclectic attitude, a mixture. He was taken from here and from there. But he was a great orator, no? Right? He has the capacity of giving great speeches. And he was involved also in politics and the social situation of the time. And he had some books like Consolation of Philosophy, about the nature of the gods, about virtues, about laws. So many, Cicero will have a great influence later on in St. Augustine. And for him, the importance of ethics again was underlined. So again, another author together with Cicero is Plutarch in the also within this Middle Platonism. Middle Platonism was that group of people, of philosophers between Plato, the origins of the Academy, and Neoplatonism with Plotinus. And this Middle Platonism, which we have Cicero, but also this Plutarch, who wrote Parallel Lives, also sort of a book of biographies of different eminent people of the time, they will try to interpret a Plato. No? So they were making an effort to try to understand who the real Plato was, because again, we have the problems, many books were not available, many, and little by little also, still in this period, Greek was the lingua franca. And as we see now, also Plotinus, they were writing in Greek. But little by little, they moved towards Latin. So now, after this long introduction of the Hellenistic period and all the evolution to understand how we reach, we see that we are now in the second century of this era, beginning of the second century of this era, and philosophy has made an emphasis on the importance of ethics, but metaphysics lost quite a lot of its own splendor. So what is being, what is the origin from which everything comes out? Well, it was studied, but were not given as much importance as before. And now when we reach to Plotinus, who lives throughout the first century, 203 to 270 approximately, we consider him founder of the Neoplatonism. Some people can say, well, no, the real founder was the teacher of Plotinus. Who was the teacher of Plotinus? The teacher of Plotinus was Ammonius Saccas, a person of whom we know almost nothing. We only know that he was the teacher of Plotinus and that he lived and had a sort of a school in Alexandria in Egypt, the north of Egypt. But besides that, we know very little. Perhaps we can guess, as it has happened with Socrates, that many of the things that Plotinus taught and many of the things that Plotinus gave us a real interpretation of Plato's doctrine came from the teachings of Ammonius Saccas. But in any case, both of them, we can give, accept that, both of them are the founders of Neoplatonism, of that attitude, of that effort, intellectual effort, to understand who really Plato was, who really Plato taught. And also, they didn't put like in an opposition, Plato against Aristotle. So they also drew from Aristotle teachings. We'll focus on Plotinus. Just if we make also a parenthesis in this evolution from Plato to Neoplatonism, we have among the Jewish, among the Jews, we have an example of Plato influence on one Bible commentator or interpreter who was Philo of Alexandria. Philo of Alexandria, who lived from 15 BC to 45 AD, was an important representative of the encounter between, in this case, Jewish civilization, Jewish religion, and Hellenistic or classical philosophy. Philo of Alexandria, with the help of the Greek background, philosophical background, interpreted and make allegorical commentaries to especially the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, that deals with the origins of the world and the origins of man. So just I mentioned, I will not go deeper into him, but as a person on whom Plato's teaching made an important influence on him. But going back to Neoplatonism, as a new philosophical movement, we can say that it's characterized by a religious philosophy. For Plotinus, philosophy should help to foster a special union between man and the divine. So, Plotinus, how did Plotinus reach? Well, he was born in the year 203 in some town in Egypt. And at the age of 27, 28, he had a desire to learn philosophy. So he moved to Alexandria and he began to seek for various teachers, which would be the suitable teacher for him. He couldn't find anyone. Finally, someone told him, "Have you ever heard of Ammonius Saccas?" And they gave him the address, the contact details. So he met him. And then he became one of Ammonius' favorite students. Immediately, Ammonius realized that Plotinus was an outstanding disciple, above the rest of the disciples. And from Ammonius, Plotinus learned about Plato, and he became also not only familiar with Plato, but also with the teachings, for instance, of the Neo-Pythagorean teachings, or by one of the Aristotelian, Alexander of Aphrodisios, and also the Stoics. So he spent, Plotinus, together in the school with Ammonius, around 11 years, and there he learned quite a lot about Plato, but also about Aristotle, about the Stoics. After 11 years, so when he was 38, 39 years old, he had a desire to know more about Eastern philosophy. So he decided to travel to Babylon, Persia, Iran nowadays, and also to India. So he wanted to learn Indian philosophy. He wanted to learn Eastern philosophy. So in the year 243, 40 years old, he joined the Roman army. Already we are in the transition, already in the time of the Roman Empire. So there was the Roman army led by Emperor Gordian III. And he joined, not in order, his aim was not to be a soldier, but just to get to know Eastern and Indian philosophy. But unfortunately, the military campaign was a failure. So absolutely, the expedition failed. The emperor did it so badly that was killed by his own troops. So Plotinus had to make a return, and he had a very risky trip in which he almost died. But finally, he managed to reach Rome, and he settled in Rome. So now from Egypt, moved to Rome in Italy, and there he settled. And of course, yeah, he was not anymore in contact with Ammonius Saccas, and he founded his own philosophical school. And somehow Plotinus felt like a man with a mission, no? And the mission of Plotinus was to shorten the gap of 600 years between Plato and him. There were 600 years in which there have been various interpretations of Plato. So what did really Plato teach? Also, we can say that his task was twofold. On the one hand, to explain really what Plato meant with his teachings. Second, to defend him from his critics, those who rejected Plato, or to try to enter into a sort of a dialogue or a sort of a refutation of their own teachings. So Plotinus founded his school in the year 245 approximately, and became a very important and very famous school, very popular school. A lot of students, people were talking about it, and also the imperial court of the Roman Empire gave a lot of approval to this new school. And the aim was to teach people the path leading to an intimate union with God by providing them with a rational explanation of reality. You see that Plotinus was also attractive, his teachings, because he was not just depicting a theory of knowledge, or we can say theoretical knowledge, but it was knowledge together with practice. He was trying to help people to grow or to follow a path leading to an intimate union with God by providing them with a rational explanation of reality. So the two things were together, and that is what make popular his school. Interestingly, he, after reading the Republic and the laws, he wanted to start a city, to found a city following the patterns given in the Republic and in the other dialogue of Plato, the laws. No? And it seems that the emperor at that time was very much in favor and wanted to help him, but then later on, those perhaps were political promises that in the moment of reality, when the money has to be given, the poor Plotinus was left aside. So in the end, never materialized, and that city used to be called Platonopolis, the city of Plato, never materialized, never became a reality. But well, it's an interesting historical data about his life. Now in this slide, you see Plotinus, Porphyry. Who was Porphyry? Porphyry was the main disciple of Plotinus and also his biographer. Porphyry put order to the writings of Plotinus. And so Plotinus was taking, writing books, text on this, on that, but he was not editing them. So there was a little disorder. So Porphyry ordered them, divided into six, that is, are called the six Enneads. Eh? Enneads is a different way of pronouncing this word, but let's say Enneads. And Enneads means group of nine. So he divided the teachings of Plotinus into six groups, and each group contained nine treatises. So that is why the total number of treatises was 54. Which were these six groups of nine treatises each? Sometimes the division is artificial, was done by Porphyry, but well, the first, Aeneid, Ethics. The second and the third, philosophy of nature and cosmology, dealing with physics in that ancient meaning of physics, of nature. The fourth, psychology. Fifth, epistemology. Sixth, metaphysics. So I repeat, the first Aeneid was ethics. The second and the third were philosophy of nature and cosmology. Fourth, psychology. Fifth, epistemology. Sixth, metaphysics. So these are, so this is the complete opera omnia of the works of Plotinus, thanks to Porphyry. And Porphyry added an introduction to his edition of the six Aeneids, and the introduction is very much biographical, it's a good biography on the life of Plotinus. It's interesting because these writings of Plotinus were not done at the beginning of his teaching in his new school, but perhaps after some years, after having taught for several years and materializing and thinking, going deep in his own teachings, he put everything into writing. And thanks to the help of Porphyry, we have them with us. So the Aeneids are like a big mosaic constructed with fragments from many sources. As I said, there is also a little bit of addition given by Porphyry, but essentially is Plotinus. Which are the central points of the teachings of Plotinus? And sometimes I will repeat ideas in order that we understand them better. The central points are the following. First, there is an absolute separation between sensible and intelligible reality, like the cosmos metos in Plato, and the world in which we live. There is a first principle, he will call it the one, and that first principle is absolutely transcendent, completely beyond everything, even beyond being. It's difficult to understand something that is, but is not is. There is also a distinction that we will come back to, this distinction of three hypostases. Hypostasis is like something underlying something else. So he will speak about the three hypostases, namely the one or the good. Sometimes he refers to it as the one, sometimes he refers to it as the good. The spirit, that is also called intellect, and the soul. These are the three hypostases. And each one proceeding from the previous one. From the one comes the intellect or spirit, and from the intellect or spirit comes the soul. So for Plotinus, here you have the three hypostases, the one, the universal intellect, and the cosmic soul. So for Plotinus, everything comes from the one. The most important element in his teaching, in his metaphysics, is the one that can be identified to God. But since when we speak about God, we say that God is the supreme being and the one is not, is beyond being, that is why he's not identified exactly with God. Though he has all the characteristics to be identified with the supreme being. So for Plotinus, as I said, everything comes from the one and one should return to the one. There should be a process of going and coming back. It's going there and then reverse coming back. Man can realize this return even in this life. There's a possibility of achieving a mystical union while we are alive. And what is specific in Plotinus' thought is to determine the ways of relating the hypostases among themselves. And we will see now how to relate the one to the universal intellect or spirit and to the cosmic soul, because there is a descendant movement from the one to the intellect, to the soul, to matter, and ascendant movements reaching back the, reaching again the one. So we see that for Plotinus, reality is structured in different levels, though each level is subordinated to the other level. And each inferior level, because the one is superior, is higher than the intellect, and the intellect is higher than the soul, and the soul is higher than the material bodies. So each inferior level derives from the immediately superior one. Everything proceeds from a principle. And this principle is, again, beyond being indeterminate, is the one. So the main difficulty, perhaps, of this doctrine is how to explain this transition from the one to the many. That is the main difficulty. But well, let's try to see how Plotinus explained it. As I said, Plotinus was convinced that he was transmitting the real teachings of Plato, adding at the same time some values from Aristotle and from the Stoics and from others. But basically, he is convinced that he is transmitting the real interpretation of Plato by stating about this, the presence of these three hypotheses. As I said, these main ideas I already mentioned before, absolute separation between sensible and intelligible reality, absolute transcendence of the first principle, and distinction among intelligible realities of the three hypostases, the one, the spirit or intellect, and the soul. Now, in order to answer to the question about the connection between the intelligible and sensible reality, Plotinus, first of all, excludes the concept of creation. all reality, visible and invisible, is one and eternal. So he, of course, he does not accept the concept of creation ex nihilo, creatio ex nihilo, the creation out of nothingness. So everything is eternal. And even though is all reality is reflected in many things, but the real truth are that, like the cosmos noetos in Plato. Plotinus also links with the concept of the Presocratics. Remember that for the Presocratics, there is a common principle, the arche, from which everything comes out. So the complex reality proceeds from a concrete principle that could be water, air, fire, etc., earth. And that arche of the Presocratic is something that is unique, something that does not have any complexity. And in addition to this teaching of the Presocratics, also he adds the teachings of Parmenides, the idea of a simple principle, an uncomplex principle, pure. So the good for Plotinus is pure simplicity. And we can only grasp what it is by deducing what it is not. There is a correlation between Plotinus' teaching and what is known as the negative theology, knowing God through what we cannot say about him. So the one is indescribable. So how do we derive the many from the one? Which is the word that Plato used for this sort of appearance of one reality after another? From the one comes the nous, the intellect, and from the intellect comes the soul, and then the matter world. He uses the word emanation. So from the one emanate the intellect. From the intellect emanates the soul. From the soul emanates the material bodies. So the concept of emanation, that is the word used by Plato, by Plotinus, should not be understood as a temporal process. So like in the first moment, we have the one, in the second moment, we have the intellect, in the third moment, we have the soul, in the fourth moment, we have the sensible world. No, this is an atemporal ontological dependence. So everything is eternal and everything depends on the other. But it's an atemporal ontological dependence. And then there is a difference between the one and the many, but this difference is not just a void, something empty. No, this between the one and the many, we have intermediaries, and here comes the hypostasis. As I said before, the hypostasis is the underlying state or the underlying substance, and is the fundamental reality that supports everything else. So underlying all objects of the world, we have the three hypostases. They are like impersonal natures, substances hierarchically ordered. The one, the intellect, the soul. And from these three main hypostases, through emanation, again, there is a process of degradation into the inferior souls and to the limits of the material world. And when we reach, we can say that limit, then begins the process of return, the process that we can call of conversion, or return, and this process leads to the what is called the Genosis, H-E-N-O-S-I-S, Genosis, that means mystical union. So in this, remember that the world is an eternal recurrence for Plotinus. So there is a process of reaching the inferior level and then going back again to the highest level. Here you see, so from the Aeneids, short definition, or description, because we can say that the one is indescribable, so it's beyond, escapes any possibility of definition. The one is all things and nowhere of them. The source of all things is not all things. All things are its possession, running back, so to speak, to it. More correctly, not yet so they will be. As you see, Plotinus is not easy to understand the one. We will have to accept it, is because since it's beyond being, it's indescribable, it's not an object of our senses, only by that mystical union of that mystical ascension we can get to know what it is. So the main philosophical question is to define the nature of these three principles, particularly the one. As I said, it should be absolutely simple without any formal determination, and it should be able to explain the multiplicity of the entire world in which we live. The one is beyond being, but all beings are being, all beings exist, we can say, because of the one. So there is that ontological dependence. We depend completely on the existence of the one. That is why the one is a supreme being. In the one, there is complete unity, not something that was very important for Plotinus was the concept of unity. Not everything has the same level of unity. The one has the perfect unity within itself. And the most unity, more reality. More unity, more reality. That is why the universe exists as a unity. But we have the one is the source of that complete unity. So in the unity that comes from the one is achieved once again by going back to that one. The one is the principle from which all multiplicity comes out. It's the cause of everything. It's the all with capital A, since it produces and keeps the being of every thing, singular thing. The first different thing that comes out of the one, as we have said, is the intellect, the nous, or spirit. And from the intellect, the soul. And the soul is the cause of the unity of the multiplicity of the physical world. Plotinus gives a lot of importance to the soul, because the soul is what gives unity to the world, while the intellect somehow is containing like a receptacle where all the forms, eternal forms, are there. So, we have read the definition. The one is all things, so the one is the cause of everything, since everything exists because of the one and from the one. But at the same time, the one is not a concrete thing, no? The source of all things is not all things. All things are its possession. So it is not, but everything that exists comes from the one. So it is a principle completely indeterminate, indescribable. So it's different from whatever is determined, is different from all beings. So the one is potency, principle, and origin from which everything proceeds and to which everything returns. Other names that Plotinus gives to the one are, for instance, king, good, monad, prime, all, God. But it's beyond all categories, absolutely transcendent, ineffable, above being, above thought itself. So, as I said, Plotinus is a clear representative of negative theology. So we can talk about the one, but in a way that we don't get knowledge about him, nor we can think about him. Let's read one of his quotations that is quite interesting about the knowledge of the one. How then do we ourselves come to be speaking of it? So how is it that we are speaking about the one? No doubt we deal with the one, but we do not state it. We have neither knowledge nor intellection of it. We do not grasp it by knowledge, but that does not mean that we are utterly void of it. And we can and do state what it is not, while we are silent as to what it is. Yeah, this is a perfect phrase exemplifying what negative theology is, that approach that we know the Supreme Being, we know God by stating what it is not, while we are silent as to what it is. Silent because we are incapable of talking. This does not mean that we can know nothing about the Supreme Being. No, our reason can, but sometimes there's this struggle between how much we can know. Can we know nothing, or can we know something, even if it is a little? Those divinely possessed and inspired, those who achieve that mystical union, have at least the knowledge that they hold some greater thing within them, though they cannot tell what it is. So yes, as in Indian philosophy, we have the concept of the Jivan Mukti. In Plotinus, we have this possibility of achieving that mystical union already in this life, to be like divinely possessed, inspired, and having that knowledge, something greater, that at the same time they are unable to explain what it is. So this definition, or this explanation of the knowledge of the one, is quite good. No? The fact that we cannot think of the one is a manifestation of the richness, of his richness in relation to us, not of his poverty. Like, we cannot speak because it's something so above everything else, so beyond our capabilities, that we cannot think, we cannot speak. We are in front of an absolute plenitude, ontologically prior to being, completely different from everything else, activity, pure freedom. The one is infinite for Plotinus in the sense of plenitude of perfection. All perfections are in him, in it. It's absolute activity in material infinitude, unlimited pure act without any determination. Well, we will see that many philosophers also speak about this. When we reach Aquinas, we will see how he spoke about the supreme esse, the supreme act of being. But the originality, we can say, of the thought of Plotinus is that the one is even above being. And that is what makes it very difficult, and that is why makes it like a great representative of the negative theology. He uses sometimes the comparison of the diffusion of light, like the sun. The sun releases energy without losing it. So it's like the one. The one also releases energy without losing it. The one is unknowable, it is even beyond God and the divine. So, as I said, sometimes the one is called God, but sometimes it's even beyond God. As I said, so in this point, perhaps if he's not absolutely clear, and it's still, till today, a matter of discussion among those scholars following Plotinus. But once we have reached that highest point, we start the descending point. Because, as we see, in the world there are a multitude of beings, human beings, animals, vegetables, and all come from the one. So how is from the one we get everything? Well, he will use the concept of images, an image of the way, of the one. The process of descending from the one to the multiplicity of beings implies multiplication, implies degradation, implies analogy. The one contains somehow the being and multiplicity which he causes, but without losing its own simplicity, the one remains simple. And this, what you have in this slide, is a quotation in which Plotinus uses a metaphor to explain the plenitude and the generative potentiality of the one. No? Here he says, existing above being, that only can be named the good, to which all is bound, and itself to none. We're all bound to the good, and the good is bound to none. The object of all aspiration, it must be unmoved, as a circumference around the center, from which all the radii proceed. Another example would be the sun. Try all you will to separate the light from the sun. Forever the light is in the sun. These are images that Plotinus is giving to explain this, the sense from the one to the many. The one does not impoverish by generating new beings, no? Because the new beings will be inferior. None of the new beings will be of the same caliber as the one. Now the question is whether the one generates necessarily or freely. And here Plotinus distinguishes two types of activities. One activity somehow that is internal. For instance, he uses the example of the fire. The fire is, by his own activities, is warm, is hot. But at the same time, the fire can heat, can transmit heat to other objects, so has an external activity without losing its own internal activity. So these are the two activities that are in the hypostasis. So in fire, there is warmth comported by its essential nature, and there is the warmth going instantaneously outward from that characterizing heat by the fact that the fire, remaining unchangeably, utters the act native to its essential reality. So the same happened with the one, with the divine. The divine remains in its own unchanging being, but from its perfection, the secondary, the rest of objects come into play. So becomes an actuality. So the generative process depends from the first action, but the essence of the one is the will to be that it is. So in the end, the procession from the one to the many is necessary. It's not like also this concept you have in Indian philosophy, the lila, no? The creation as a game. But in Plotinus, there is a necessity, there is a need that the external world comes to exist, come into action, into actuality. So the procession of things from the one is a will necessity, is needed, but at the same time will by the same one. No? In the end, is free and not free, free and needed. That is really a topic of discussion among Plotinus scholars. Now we go to the second hypostasis, the intellect or spirit, or nous, is the first derivation from the one, and is the locus of all Platonic forms, as I said, all the eternal and immutable entities of whatever exists are there in the intellect, like a receptacle, we can say, like a big container. And there we have all the Platonic forms that are eternal, immutable entities of whatever exists. And why is an intellect necessary postulated among the forms? We can have the forms, but Plotinus added the idea of the intellect, okay, like a receptacle. Well, Plotinus explained that he adds the concept of the intellect as a place for the forms, taking it from the Timaeus, that famous dialogue of Plato about the origin of the world, in which Plato speaks about the demiurge, like an intermediate being between God and the creatures and the world, like a creator. No? Well, the demiurge is thinking itself, and in itself, he sees all eternal forms. So this idea also of the intellect contemplating itself, and by contemplating itself, contemplating all the forms. And then when the forms exist on earth, we'll be recollecting, remembering, like in the teachings of Plato, what they have seen while they were in the intellect, thinking itself. So the intellect is being. The one is not being, but the intellect is being, containing in itself all the ideas, the cosmos noetos, and is the first and more intense unity after the one. Remember that for Plato, for Plotinus, unity is the most important concept. And the one is the most perfect unity after the one. The intellect is the most intense unity. It's the first determination proceeding from the one. It contains everything, all the species existing on the world, as the whole contains the parts. Yeah, the intelligible, sometimes Plotinus compare with like the rays of the one. No, they don't exist because the intellect thinks them, but the intellect thinks them because they are ab eterno. So the forms exist, are eternal. Plotinus distinguishes, as we said before, between the internal and external activity of things. In the case of the one, which is the internal activity, its own existence, above everything else, and in the case of the intellect, again, the internal activity is that the intellect is contemplating itself. And contemplating itself, contemplating all the forms that are within him. But at the same time, that intellect, together with the next hypostasis, that is the soul, will produce the world of concrete objects, of multiple objects. So the internal activity of the soul as image of the spirit, at the third hypostasis, the soul is thought also, is activity of the spirit. The internal activity of the soul includes all psychical activities of embodied beings. And the external activity is just nature, is the sensible world, the creation of the sensible world. No? So after the one, the intellect and the soul, comes the sensible world in which we live. No? The soul becomes united to particular bodies, and a multiplication of souls. The soul is interior movement, a desire of knowing and of being. It causes external movement, and that external movement is the physical reality. So the soul moves around the spirit, around the intellect, and around the nature that produces. Again, no? From where does matter come? Because there is no concept of creation. So we have to conclude in this topic of the existence of matter, that matter is eternal. And matter in itself is not evil because it's eternal, okay? But can, in the process of union between matter and forms, matter and spirit, can produce sometimes evil consequences. So matter admits two dimensions. One is, as I said, intelligible nature, the substrates of all the multiplicity of ideas existing in the spirit. And another one, sensible, that is similar to the potentiality in Aristotle. Okay. The matter is capacity to be that, this object, the other object. Again, with the concept of image that Plotinus uses, in order to explain the role of matter, Plotinus uses the example of an image that requires the existence of a mirror. If there is no mirror, there's no image. Okay? I am myself, but if I look myself in a mirror, then my image is there. So the image needs in order to exist, needs a mirror. The mirror does not contain what is reflected on it. So again, matter is the nothingness on which the being appears. Matter is invisible, is pure potentiality, but indispensable. If we don't have matter, we will not have the object of this world. And the objects of this world are just mere images, reflections, because they come by a way of degradation from the one. Again, the Platonic, remember the allegory of the cave, the simile of the line that we saw in the previous two classes before, when we discussed the Book of the Republic, and we saw how at the beginning we see images, we see shadows in that state, mental state of akasia, and only through an effort we can go up, up, up to know the idea of the good, the forms. So these are clearly an interpretation of Plato by Plotinus. Everything derives from the first principle, but in this process of degradation. So we can underline three important ideas. One, in this degrading process, no, from the one to the material things. First, we can say that there is a pantheistic approach in Plotinus, because there is an identity of nature among all beings. And this pantheistic approach is characterized by the concept of procession of emanation. We spoke of emanation, that is a temporal dependence on something else. So it's not a temporal process, but because the universe is eternal. But all the objects in the world permanently, atemporal, eternally depend on the one, on the highest principle. Second, there is no concept of creation. Beings are uncreated, exist, though there is an evolution, emanation. And third, even though he made use of the book of the Timaeus, but in and also the idea of the demiurge, but in Plotinus there is no concept of Platonic demiurge, like having that forming function. No? The forms are there, and the matter is a principle that emanates from the other principles and gets united to those forms and producing the concrete objects. So we have done the degrading path, no? From the one to the intellect, to the soul, to the material beings. And we can see that matter is exists eternally, is pure potentiality, and gets united to the form. So now we have to see the inverse process, the return. So Plotinus affirms that man is his soul. That is the important thing. Is the soul the one that transmits life, movement, unity, order, and beauty to the body? Everything comes from the form. And the body is embraced by the soul. The souls are subsistent realities, are divine, are immortal. All of them are unified in the unity of the universal soul. The soul, as the third hypostasis, is the unity of all the, we can say, the existing souls that then will be united to particular bodies. The relationship with the bodies is involuntary, but it is voluntary assumed, and by it they vivify the bodies. It's something that is part of the system, but the unity between body and soul is a negative one, since it implies dispersion. That is why unity between body and soul should end at a particular time. Besides descending towards matter, the souls have this ascending movement towards the divine, and in order to reach the one, the soul should traverse a path that is made up of several stages, like steps, one after another, till we reach the one. And this ascension, again, as it was the case with Plato, is not only intellectual, but implies an ethical path, a path of purification, by which we are able to discover our own nature. What is essential is a contemplative attitude, the ecstasy by which duality is suppressed. And in the end, it's a process by which the soul recovers its own identity, its own totality. Here in this quotation, you see the man formed by this mingling with the supreme must carry its image impressed upon him. Man becomes unity, nothing within him or without inducing any diversity. All the being calm, he turns neither to this side nor to that, not even inwards to himself. Utterly resting, he has become very rest. When the soul begins again to mount, it comes not to something alien, but to its very self. It is in the supreme. So the Plotinian universe is unified. It's a perfect and eternal life in which multiplicity is governed by unity. From the one shine rays of light, and this is the ontological dissipation, no, in this, in the intellect, in the soul, in the objects of the world. But then the return, together with ethical process of purification and with human efforts, re-obtain that unity. That is why, summarizing the teachings of Plotinus, we see that conclusive remarks of Plotinus, the one is beyond thought and being. In the one, there is no duality of substance and accident, as we had in Aristotle, remember, no, the nine categories, together with the substance, 10 categories. No positive attributes are ascribed to the one. The existence of finite beings are fruit of emanation, and they come out of necessity. And 7 points can summarize, to some extent, the teachings of Plotinus. First idea, there's a plurality of levels of being, and they are arranged in a hierarchical descending order. From the one to the lowest, that is the physical universe. Remember, the one, the intellect, the soul, the physical universe. Second, each level of being is derived from its superior, a derivation that is not a process in time or space, a derivation that is called emanation and implies ontological dependence on the highest level. Third, each level derived is established in its own reality by turning back towards its superior level in a movement of contemplative desire, which is implicit in the original creative impulse of outgoing that it received from its superior. So each level implies to look back to the superior level with a desire of contemplation, with a desire of going back to that higher level. Like the myth of the cave, not to forget that we can be like prisoners chained, looking at the world illuminated by the shadows of the fire, and forgetting what is the real truth. Each level of being is an image of the one above it, that is an archetype. Fifth, the degrees of being are also degrees of unity. As one goes down, there is greater multiplicity, the multiplicity of the world in which we live. Sixth, the highest level of being derived from the ultimate principle, which is beyond being. We have said this many, many times today's lecture. That is the one, complete simplicity, also sometimes called the good, source of all perfections and ultimate goal of return. And the seventh point is that since this supreme principle is absolutely simple and undetermined, man, the knowledge that man, the human being can have of it, is radically different from any other type of knowledge that we have of physical objects. So it is not, it can only be known if it raises the mind to an immediate union with itself. And this is mystical union. And this is the achieved only by a life of purification, of virtue, of effort, and of contemplation. So the written works of Plotinus, the Aeneas, that are this collection of 54 books, treatises divided into sets of 9, from there comes the word Aeneas, explain how from the eternal creative act of that transcendent source, the one, proceeds the world of living reality, and is constituted by a repeated double movements of outgoing and return in contemplation. For Plotinus, the entire universe is a living organic whole, an imperfect reflection of the living unity in diversity that you have in the world of forms and moreover in the ones. Man can ascend through his own intellect to the level of universal soul. And that is why for Plotinus, philosophy was a sort of a religion. However, there's no room for revelation. Plotinus does not make use of any books of revealed doctrines or revealed teachings. And there's no also place for grace of God. Everything is done with human effort, human contemplation. Also the concept of repentance is not present in the teachings of Plotinus. For him, the combination of moral purification through virtues and intellectual enlightenment is the only way to union with the good. And just in these few minutes, after having finished Plotinus, just to talk about few of the Neoplatonists, those who follow Plotinus. Well, of course, after Plotinus, we have Porphyry, whom we mentioned because he's his disciple and the one who edited his works. But Porphyry is also interesting because he wrote a book called the Isagoge, and the Isagoge is an incorporation of Aristotle's logic. Concretely, the Isagoge transmits the teachings of Aristotle on his book, The Categories, about the nouns and about the concepts that apply to the different actions of human being. So, and it's interesting because thanks to Porphyry, the logic of Aristotle became very popular, began to be translated later on. There is Boethius, who translated the rest of the logic works. Remember the Organum, the logic works written by Aristotle. So that is why the Aristotelian logic became well known already in Europe, and we didn't need to wait for other for centuries, like has happened with the other teachings of Aristotle, for example, the ethics, the politics, etc., that only in the 13th century or 12th century was people were able to know through to good translations. So, but Porphyry is known for these two great contributions. First, to have it transmitted to us the complete works of Plotinus in the Aeneas. Second, for transmitting the part of the Aristotelian logic in his Isagoge. Other was Iamblichus, who was a person from the Syrian school of Platonism, and he continues, he transformed the edifice of Plotinus, and by multiplying the hypostases. If Plotinus gave us 3 hypostases, the one, the intellect, and the soul, well, he has multiplied and he has increased the number of hypostases and the different levels of being. It was a much he emphasized the importance of the religious ascension, of going up in that ladder, climbing from one step into another. Also, Iamblichus, as I said, sometimes there were conflicts between the religion of the state, the religion of the philosophers, and the religion also of Christianity that was spreading in those centuries. So Iamblichus tried to reconcile philosophy with Roman religion, tries to provide a theological justification of Roman polytheism, and at the same time in his teaching there is a theurgic component, a sort of a liturgy, a praxis or a liturgical praxis by which he can facilitate that union. So for him, for Iamblichus, the union with the divinity does not depend only on human forces, but also comes through grace, through the practice of rituals, through a liturgical tradition and practice. Proclus also is important. He wrote many books, and one is Elements of Theology that was very well known in the Middle Ages. And also he introduces the existence of several hierarchical constituting his intelligible universe. So you see that this division of hypostasis that Plotinus made was continued by his disciple, by Iamblichus, and by Proclus. Also, Proclus made an effort to defend the whole religion, and also he was influenced by some religious texts like the Chaldean oracles and Orphic poems that explain that or present the human soul as a spiritual being of lower rank who has descended and now should go up again. So Neoplatonism will come to an end in the year 529 with the closing of the academy founded by Plato 9 centuries earlier. But Platonism influenced all those centuries, also will influence, we will see next class, the first Christian theologians from the middle of the second century onwards, more than the Stoics, even though there are some influence of the Stoicism, but some of the teachings of the Stoicism were conflicting with some Christian tenets. That is why Platonism is more influential on their teachings than Stoicism. The influence of Platonism, of course, did not end with the closing of the academy, continued throughout the entire history of Western philosophy till today. And that we say when we spoke about him, that always we can put people as Platonics or followers of Plato or non-followers of Plato. And at the same time, we should not forget Aristotle. The thing with Aristotle was a complex process of the editing and the apparition of the discovery of his works, that, and then the translation. That is why sometimes Aristotle was less known, but not that was left aside. It was due to various circumstances. So Platonism and Aristotelianism have never been separated in the history of European thought. There was already a strong Aristotelian element in the Middle Platonism and in Neoplatonism. Finally, we can say that Plotinus represents the final form of Greek philosophy. It's a one-sided development of Plato's teachings, but incorporated many Aristotelian and Stoic elements as well. He's not repeating what others have said in the past. He's integrating them in his own synthesis of great originality. And from a geographical point of view, we started in the 3rd-4th century BC with the Hellenic world, with Hellenism, and we finished already in the 4th-5th century in the times of the Roman Empire. So we see now how the world has changed. All the entire North Africa is part of the Roman Empire, the entire Europe, Western Europe. then of course the what is Peloponnese, Greece, and what is Asia Minor, no? Turkey nowadays. So all this now is the Roman Empire, and during the Roman Empire, the main two cities would be Rome and Constantinople. Why? Because the Roman Empire at the particular moment will be divided into the Western and the Eastern. And this will be very important for the future classes of philosophy, because the Western, in the Western Roman Empire, the lingua franca was Latin, while in the Eastern Roman Empire, the lingua franca was Greek. So we finished the class. I stopped sharing, and now I'm, if you want any question or any clarification, I'm available.
Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful session. I request all the participants, if you have any question, please raise your hand so that I can unmute you and you can directly ask the question to Dr. Kiturbek.
Thank you. And this has been a difficult task to understand Plotinus. He himself is saying that it's impossible to describe. So sometimes we say, well, what can we ask if he says that it's impossible to describe? No, but it's important to understand that concept of the emanation and the hypostasis.
Even in our Sanskrit, in our Indian philosophy, there comes one word, as you just mentioned, that it is difficult to describe. In Sanskrit, we come across one word as anirvachaniya. In the Upanishads, they say that if you want to explain that ultimate reality, which in the Upanishadic language, they call it as Brahman. So they say that it is beyond the explanation. It cannot be explained with the help of words. So this is the same thing as you are explaining.
Yes. And it was interesting what I mentioned, that he wanted to learn about Indian philosophy because he joined that military expedition. Unfortunately, the expedition failed, but we don't know whether he managed to read anything related to Indian philosophy or not. We don't have evidence of that. No?
Yes. There is one question, sir. Does the Plotinus theory correlates with Indian philosophy Sankhya?
Well, I don't think so. Perhaps this you can answer better the question, Raksha, but
because
of the all the hypostasis, no, that you will not have, you have all the elements in Samkhya, but this emanation of the hypostasis, I think you don't have it in Samkhya, if I'm not wrong.
Yes. Now, I also don't know much about the Plotinus and the philosophy, but whatever you have explained, after listening to your lecture, I personally feel that it is more related to the Vedanta philosophy, not with the Sankhya philosophy. So there can be some correlation, there can be some similarities between Vedanta and Plotinus, because in Sankhya, there are so many different topics which may not be matching with the Plotinus philosophy.
Yes, I also think that if you check into theses or books, conferences, that always Neoplatonism has been compared with Vedanta philosophy more than with Samkhya or other school of Indian philosophy.
Yes, yes. Okay, I think, sir, there is no any other question.
Okay.
So, shall we stop here for today's session?
Yes. We can finish.
Thank you so much for, again, giving the wonderful lecture. And today we completed the 5 sessions and there are 5 still more to go. So we are really looking forward to attend all your sessions. And I'm sure that those who are attending this lecture series on Introduction to Western Philosophy, they will definitely be interested in the future to learn all these philosophical doctrines in detail. So we may think of planning in-depth sessions also in the future, because people are really interested and we are uploading these videos on YouTube also. So definitely many other people will also get benefited from that. So thank you so much for the wonderful session. And I request all the participants to join once again on coming Thursday for the next session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rudraksha, and thank you to all of you.